If I asked what is the most important aspect of being a top player, most of us would assume insane aim. There was a time where I would have agreed with you, but lately I've started to see that being a high elo player isn't just about aim, but actually more about being the complete package. What's going on, Pro Guides fam? Kangas here, and today I'm talking about how trying to impose your aim on your opponents can actually result in you losing close games, and why trying to focus on your development in other aspects of the game can actually lead to ranking up way quicker. Also, in case you haven't noticed, we actually changed our Pro Guides logo, and I'm really curious what y'all think about it. I think it looks sick as hell, but let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Recently, American Counter-Strike star Alige tweeted, "If you want to be a top-level player, you need to identify your edge. What makes you unique?" He then proceeded to list some skills that fit the bill, such as being a good communicator or playing well with your teammates. You may have noticed that he didn't mention aim being something that you should focus on to make you stand out. That isn't necessary to say that you shouldn't practice aim or try to develop it though. In a follow-up tweet, he did say, "I didn't say good aim and wonder why. When you're a pro-level player, everyone has good aim and it's rarely the difference maker." And this is where I completely agree with Alige. What separates Zywoo or Simple, undoubtedly the two best CSGO players in the world, from mechanical gods like Nico, is their understanding of the game. They understand and feel the game on a next level that's almost inhuman. It seems like they always know the right play and are constantly two steps ahead of their opponents. They always got the right angle, they always win the clutch, and very rarely do they have bad games. Of course, aim is a big driving force of what makes them exceptional players, but the aim is a tool after they've secured the edge through game sense. Now, besides the obvious RR difference, there are several fundamental reasons why some players can't get to Immortal or stay in it. Since Valorant is a first-person shooter, obviously aim will matter. I would obviously be lying if I said it didn't. Some can even argue that at the core, the game is just pointing at people's heads and clicking. Aim is important, but it can only take you so far in the ranked ladder. What separates Platinums and Diamonds, or even Diamonds and Immortals, is often their understanding of the core fundamentals of the game. This isn't talking about their basic understanding of the game, rather their game sense, their positioning, and understanding how to make plays with their available abilities. These are the most often neglected sides of the game, overshadowed by the thrill of hitting a clean flick or watching a pro's crisp clean lock onto his enemies. Yet, you cannot escape it, it's present everywhere, and it's what drives consistency in gameplay. Now, I'm sure we've all had games where we go on a heater and mechanically outclass the opposition because we are in the zone. Obviously, we feel great and we're on our A game, but I'm sure we also realize that this doesn't happen every game. When you're having one of these games, you go for picks that you wouldn't traditionally go for or play just way more aggressive than usual, riding off your own confidence fueled by your aim. But what happens whenever your aim isn't on point, but you still try to play like this? Well, you often get shut down and almost silenced in games, repeatedly dying and possibly looking out of your depth, or even end up just tilting yourself to play even worse next game. So naturally, it's important to have a game plan and the right fundamentals to fall back on whenever you're not having those unstoppable games. But before we move on with how aim can potentially make you worse as a player, we got our question of the day. What do you think is your strongest in-game skill? I'm not a crazy flick player and I'm not the best mechanically, so my best strength is just remaining calm and being able to read what my opponent is trying to do. If you haven't checked out a previous video about mind games, that's one of my favorite things to do in a game like Valorant. Guessing what my opponent's play is and then trying to make a counter of my own and communicating that to my teammate is really the strength that I bring to my team. But like I said, let me know what you think is your strongest in-game skill in the comments down below, and I'll be sure to read them all. Now, one of the major skills I see lower ranked players and even higher ranked players lacking is their ability to position themselves. Good positioning allows you to turn fights in your favor by catching the enemy off guard or making a duel be in your favor just based on the angle or weapon advantage that you have. By relying on just aim, you can find yourself playing in a way that you try to unnecessarily force your aim onto others to get kills. This can result in you taking way unfavorable gunfights and then losing them when you shouldn't have even taken them in the first place. For example, peeking up close against a team full of eco buys. Even though you're technically favored to win the fight, you're creating unnecessary risk and potentially losing your gun to a rush, and also playing to their weapons range. Instead, you could be playing much more passive and forcing your weapons range advantage against them. Now, while you may have confidence that your aim is better than your opponent's, this won't matter if you're more often than not dead after killing one or dying because of bad positioning. Well thought out and adaptable positioning is one of the most important skills in Valorant, in my opinion. In a match against Sova or Sky, you'll often find yourself compromised due to their utility if you try to hold too aggressive of angles. The ability to reposition can be the difference between life and death in lots of these cases. Like, let's say you're behind Black Box in the top mid split and Sky's dog sees you. Unless you're a Jett or an Omen, you're practically screwed because you have no way to escape. You may be able to swing and kill an enemy, but a one-for-one trade usually favors the attackers, which could cause you to lose a crucial round or even the game. Good positioning is a key fundamental skill as it complements your aim and makes kills easier to get. When I started working with the Valorant coaches, this is one of the first things that they told me to work on, and after working on it, my rank skyrocketed. My aim would often allow me to go for one for ones, but my position would rarely do me any favors after that first kill. So working on this specifically really helped me out. And yeah, going one for one doesn't always sound bad, but it definitely won't carry you to wins more often than not. If you're trying to climb, your life needs to be worth more than just one instantly traded kill. Basically, what I'm saying is by focusing on improving your positioning, you can maximize your chances of multi-kills, therefore increasing your impact on the game overall and helping you carry yourself to a higher rank and also improving your star player potential. Now, we've already touched on overconfidence, but let's go into more detail now. Being confident in yourself is crucial. If you don't think that you can kill the player, odds are you probably won't. If you're too hesitant, you'll only hurt yourself when you take a duel, so being decisive when you take a fight is a really important skill. However, there's a difference between confident based on knowledge and overconfidence based on feeling. On one note, you can peak confidently because you know your positioning is strong or you created an advantage through agent abilities or communication. The other side that borders arrogance is when you peak because you think you're better and forgetting smart play in the process. This can result in taking very bad fights that can even have the result of shutting down your future confidence. As the saying goes, too much of a good thing can be bad, and in this case it definitely is. I don't know about you, but I've definitely started games going 10-0, absolutely dominating the opposition and pushing as if my life depended on it. Eventually, the enemy team will catch on to your aggression or your tendency to overpeak, resulting in them punishing it and you being out of the round. This in itself shouldn't shake you and shouldn't immediately lose you all of your confidence. Rather, you should try and adapt your playstyle and just tone it back a bit. But instead of doing that, I see lots of players go for the same fights over and over again because they're feeling confident, overconfident, and disregarding objectively good play. Often they have the mindset that the enemy got lucky or they barely missed, so they won't next time, rather than actually understanding that just because they have the ability to win the fight doesn't mean that they should try and take it. Sometimes the risks outweigh the rewards, but overconfidence will restrain that mindset because you're just feeling it. Overconfidence is a killer. It can lead you to do some really dumb plays that you would never do otherwise, and can lead to some heartbreaking throws or losses that will undoubtedly hurt your mental. Another issue with relying too much on aim is overpeaking. And honestly, this is a problem that I think that we can all relate to. Overpeaking is peaking whenever you shouldn't, or peaking too much when you commit to your fight. It's usually a sign that you're too confident in your aim and disregarding tactics. More often than not, the best you'll get out of these plays is a kill and get traded. And at worst, you don't even get the kill and end up in the open with no escape. When you do win, it's purely off your aim and rarely any other factors. And just to be clear, if you're peeking wide with a flash, it's not the same as overpeaking. And you don't have to just take it from me, I saw Team Liquid JP say in a vlog, everyone gets one overpeak per game. And thinking about it, this is a really useful unwritten rule to have. Overpeaking can lose your team control and even rounds, so make sure you're not doing it too much. While it can seem like a small mistake in the grand scheme of things, doing this over and over again adds up pretty quickly, and you're cooking up a perfect recipe to lose a game that was totally in your hands. So listen to Jampy, one per game. While we're told in school there's no such thing as a bad question, this doesn't translate to plays in Valorant. There's nothing more frustrating than seeing somebody try to justify a bad play just because it worked. Bad plays are a bit like gambling. Sometimes you do win, but more often than not, the house wins. The main difference between a good play and a bad play is that a good play has a high percentage chance of success, while a bad play has a high percentage chance of failure. And this is most definitely the case for bad plays based on aim. Just because you did a bad play and one-tapped three people once doesn't mean it's likely to ever happen again. If you want to have the most consistency as a player, you want to strive for high percentage plays. And that means taking the right fights, having the right positioning, and having good communication. Aim factors into this in a very interesting fashion. Depending on your level of aim, bad plays become okay plays, and good plays become great plays. Aim increases your chances of succeeding when you make a play, if everything else is kept constant. As such, having great aim is a wonderful asset to your skill as a player, like I had said before, but it doesn't mean that a bad play is now a good one because your aim is on point. Now, there are of course caveats to this. As you reach higher levels of skill, your aim will inevitably reach a point where certain plays become accessible to you that would never have worked otherwise. For example, you can often see pro players hold angles that are really close to the wall. If you were to do the same thing, you'd probably be unable to react in time to hit them, or you'd be unable to adjust if they swing too fast. In these situations, your aim enables you to make a play that you never could before. However, I'm pretty confident in saying that in 99% of cases, having good aim does not justify a strategically bad play. Making a bad peek is still a bad peek, but a person with good aim might be able to get away with it more. This is dangerous because a player with good aim but bad game sense might think that the play they make is justified because sometimes it works for them. What's forgotten though is that if the player instead made a good play, then they will almost always succeed because their aim is that nail in the coffin that makes the good play a great one. Shallow successes like kills breed complacency that can really hinder your improvement as a player. Having good aim causes some players who are overconfident to justify the bad plays that they make, and as a result, it hurts their progress with other aspects of the game because they just rely on their aim too much and it shapes their perception of the game. This is something that we often call results-oriented thinking, and it's not a really good way of approaching becoming a better player and improving. Since the game still has a level of randomness and it's a competitive game where you play against different opponents, there's rarely a play that will 100% work all the time. That means results-oriented thinking can lead you into many mental traps that could work against you without you even knowing it. Playing consistently well is far more rewarding practically than being inconsistently amazing. To summarize, you can think of it this way: playing consistently well is way more rewarding than being inconsistently amazing. By drilling it into your own head that bad plays are bad plays regardless of the result, you have the potential for actually breaking out of bad habits and learning to play the game at a high level. By refining and improving upon them, you can more consistently have impact rounds than going for the high-risk plays that might be Reddit clip worthy, but will lose you the round most of the time. Of course, there are times where you need to pull out some of that inner monkey to win an unwinnable round, but that's not what you should always be relying on. So to conclude, having good aim is a good place to start on your route to the top, but it isn't the be-all and end-all. I'm sure there are players in ranked who have better aim than pro players, but don't have all the necessary skills and attributes to make it to the professional level. If you've played Kovacs before, you can easily see that some of the best aimers on Kovacs are nowhere to be seen in competitive FPS games. It's not necessarily because they're bad at the game, but that aim alone is not enough to be the best. By focusing on eliminating some of the negative baggage that comes with good aim and little experience, you can expect to see way more growth as a player and steadily rank up. But that's all that we have for the video. If you enjoyed, please remember to leave a like, comment, and subscribe. It really helps us out bringing more content just like this. Also, make sure to hit that bell notification so that you always stay up to date with the latest Valorant news, updates, and more. Once again, I've been Kangas. Good luck on the grind, everybody, and I'll see you in the next one.